an Irish bar. Walking along Charlestown, wishing you were Bannerstrand, holding your nephew's hands. We walked along the waterfront, up Bunker Town on Main. We met at the monument, where everyone knew our names. Our first kiss on 40 flights, our friends on the stoop on summer nights. The church door was always open as the bells rang out for you and me, for all to see on our wedding day. There's an immigrant soul under Southern stars.
Good evening and welcome to Charlestown Live. I'm Tom Coots and I'll be your host for this evening's show. Before we begin, as always, we'd like to thank our partner, Charlestown Against Drugs, and our sponsor, Partners Healthcare, which includes the following: MGH Charlestown, MGH Institute of Health Professionals, Spalding Rehabilitation Hospital, and the MGH Sharp Program. Without their generous support, we could not bring this show to you this evening. I'd like to remind you that this is a live call-in show, and you can call us here in the studio at 617-708-3290. And the number is up there on the bottom of the screen so that you'll be able to remember it tonight. So if you have any questions for me or for my host tonight, feel free to call. Would like to just take a moment right now. This is 2 days after Veterans Day, but I still call it Veterans Day week, and I'd like to take a moment to thank all of our veterans for serving this country. I appreciate everything that you have done and everything that you still continue to do. Remember that we have not forgotten your sacrifice and your service to this country. I've got a couple of announcements tonight. From now through the end of this year, Charlestown Live will be urging viewers and guests to donate to Harvest on Vine Food Pantry in Charlestown. Their need is great. Currently, they're helping over 700 families here in Charlestown to put food on their tables. And it is our hope that you will send a donation in, or that you will be able to come down to the Cooperative Bank at 201 Main Street to drop up some food, or at 49 Vine Street, or even at the Parish Hall on 46 Winthrop Street in Charlestown. Right now they're collecting soups, canned goods, chowders, instant packages of noodles and soup for the winter months, or any other non-perishable food items, including rice and cereal. So we want to just urge you to continue to do that, to help out some of the families there here in Charlestown. I have another announcement coming up this weekend. St. John's is holding their annual Harvest Fair this Saturday, November 15th from 10 to 2. There will be a turkey dinner at noontime, and that is at 27 Devon Street in Charlestown. Drop on by and enjoy yourself for a wonderful day of celebrating the harvest time in Charlestown. Tonight, my guest is a returning guest, a good friend of mine, Professor David Hennessy, Professor Emeritus at Babson College, and also Vice President of the Charlestown Historical Society and Program Director. So welcome, David. Thank you for coming again tonight.
Thanks, Tom. It's great to be here.
Apparently, I didn't bore you too much last time or scare you too much last time. You did come back to talk with us. Tonight, I'd like to talk about a subject that you have done a program on, John Boyle O'Reilly. I've worked in Charlestown for quite a few years, and I've heard the name. I've seen the name written, but until just recently, I didn't know too much about him. But you've done some really good research on the life of John Boyle O'Reilly. So tell us a little bit about who was John Boyle O'Reilly.
John Boyle O'Reilly was an Irishman. He was born in Ireland in Drogheda, which is about 20 miles or 25 miles north of Dublin. Okay. And he was born in 1844. His father was a schoolmaster, and his mother took care of the family, which was a large family of five daughters and three sons. And John was one of their sons, and had a very, very interesting life.
Well, I don't know if I read it, or I believe I might have, when you and I were speaking earlier, he was raised in a castle.
Correct.
In Ireland, but he wasn't Irish royalty.
Right. The castle actually was owned by the Viscount of Netherville, And when he died, in his will, he left the castle and some funds to take care of widows and orphans. And so the castle actually became a school.
So his father was a teacher, a headmaster over this group of orphan children, and he taught them.
Yes. And both his father and mother were educated. His father was a math teacher and became headmaster, and his mother was into English literature.
So he grew up in a very well-educated family.
Mm-hmm.
And did he continue on to college, or what was his childhood like?
Well, it's interesting. I mean, he was born in 1844, which was 1 year before the potato famine. The potato famine was from 1845 to 1852. So it was a difficult time in Ireland that he was born, but because of his parents' connection with the Institute, they had enough food and clothing and were able to live a normal, comfortable life. He played with his brothers and sisters up until about the age of 11. At 11, he actually took a job as a typesetter in the local newspaper, a job that his older brother was supposed to take, but his older brother got TB and the family still needed the money. So John Boyle O'Reilly got up every morning at 5:30 and went to set type.
So at age 11, he more or less stopped his education and went to work to support the family.
Actually, he would say he started his education because everything he typeset, he read, and he became very well read on what was happening in Ireland and the rest of the world.
So he got his education through reading the type that he was setting.
Correct. And after a couple of years, and unfortunately, the person that owned the paper died, and so the paper went out of business. And then his family sent him to England to actually live with an aunt and uncle and work on a newspaper in Prescott, England.
So what age was he when his family sent him away?
He was 15.
So at age 15, his parents sent him from Ireland over to England to live with a family member. Now, was he working then to send money back home to the family to continue to help?
Yeah, he was working to help support the family.
Wow.
And while he was there, he also got involved in the military. He became a member of the Lancaster Rifle Volunteers, which was a British military unit, a volunteer unit. I sort of think of it as sort of the military Boy Scouts, because they would train every weekend and camping and orienteering. And so he liked the camaraderie of that group.
A bit of a fraternal organization, quasi-military.
Yeah.
Now,
but yeah, it was British and Irish.
That's what I was just going to ask. And how does an Irishman end up over in England and join an English military?
Yeah.
Or at the time, I guess in the 19th century, Ireland was still considered part of Great Britain.
Yeah.
Okay.
According to the British, it was part of Great Britain. Not all the Irish agreed with that.
Oh, okay. I can see how they might differ in their opinion. So did he continue on in the military, or?
Well, at the age of 19, he came back to Ireland and took a full-time job in the Royal Hussein Military Troopers, which was the Duke of what was the Duke's.
The Duke's regiment?
Yeah, his
now,
regiment.
Now, the Hussars, that's a horse troop.
Correct.
A troop is a horse troop. So these are the guys with the curved swords and the fancy. So again, he's moving from one military organization to another.
Right. But this was a full-time military organization run by the English. And at that point in time, that's when John took a turn. And he joined the Fenians, and the Fenians was an ultra-secret organization of Irish men and women who wanted to overthrow the English.
Okay, so you've got an Irishman who's in the English army, but secretly part of a secret organization to overthrow the government in which he's supposed to be serving as a soldier.
Correct, and he was trying to actually convert other soldiers of an Irish background to become part of the Fenians. So once they got enough Fenians, they could take over the military unit, use their guns, horses and everything else provided by the English against the English.
So he was a spy, more or less, undercover.
I think he would consider himself to be called a patriot rather than
okay.
a spy.
All right, that's fair enough, a patriot.
But the police actually raided the secret newspaper of the Fenians and somehow found out about John Boyle O'Reilly. And he was arrested, and he was tried, and he was convicted and was sentenced to death.
Now, behind us we have some photos of John Boyle O'Reilly.
Yep. That's his prison picture right there, and it says John Boyle O'Reilly on it in the center.
Okay.
And for some reason, which I don't really know the reason, he took a tour of the prison system in Ireland and in England, and ended up going to 6 different prisons. He made 3 escape attempts from those prisons, and then eventually was sent to Australia, to the penal colonies.
So he gets arrested, being part of this Fenian society to overthrow the government. They send him off to prison. He takes a tour of 6 separate prisons, attempts to escape how many times?
3 times.
3 times. And then they send him off to Australia. Now, obviously, Australia is, at the time, probably the most severe place that you could send someone to be in a prison colony. So he goes to Australia. So at that time, point in time, he would have had to have gone, I'm assuming, by ship.
Mm-hmm.
So how long of a voyage was it to from England to Australia?
It was a 3-month voyage, and it was on a ship called the Hougoumont ship. And the interesting thing about this ship, it wasn't that big of a ship, but it had 431 people on it, mm-hmm. Of which only 62 were Fenians. The rest were convicts of other sorts.
So there were other prisoners, not just the Fenian society. So murderers, robbers, thieves.
Yeah, the normal everyday crooks.
Normal crooks.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, what was interesting about it is this: it seems like whatever situation John Boyle O'Reilly was in, he'd figure out a way to make it turn to in his advantage. And what he did on this ship was go to the captain and get permission to publish a newspaper on the ship, which the newspaper was called the Wild Goose Newspaper.
So on his way from one prison to another prison, he talks the captain into allowing him to start a newspaper.
Correct.
This guy was a smooth talker.
Yeah, it was an 8-page newspaper. It was 4 people that did all the writing.
Here we are, the Wild Goose.
This is the Wild Goose. 4 people did all the writing. And then on every Sunday, they would read the newspaper to all the Irishmen on the ship.
Now, I see that looking at the newspaper off to the left, it appears that it's handwritten. Obviously, there was no printing press aboard ship.
Correct.
So did they make numerous copies or just read the one copy over and over?
They just read the one copy over and over. And the copies actually still exist. One of the other writers that wrote The Wild Goose, his daughter actually has the 7 issues of The Wild Goose newspaper.
Wow. Well, he was quite a clever guy to be able to do that. So now he arrives in Australia 3 mm-hmm. months later.
Yep.
And he has a 20-year prison sentence.
Right.
And I'm assuming from everything that I've ever heard about the Australian penal colony is that it was hard labor.
So, correct. And he was sentenced to hard labor. Although, again, John Boyle O'Reilly figured out a way to make it work to his advantage. He became friendly with a priest, Father Lynch, who ran the library. And because John could read and write, he recruited John Boyle O'Reilly to the library, where John studied the newspapers and read as much as he could while he was there.
Okay. So did he end up with a librarian's job, or did he?
It was a librarian's job, although pretty quickly Father Lynch figured out a way to get him out of the prison and onto a job in the countryside.
So what was he doing in the countryside, you know, cutting down trees or?
Yeah, he was part of a group that was building a road, but his role was as a convict constable.
Convict constable. So you've got a guy who's a convict, a prisoner, but as a constable, he has a leadership role.
Correct.
What did he do as the constable?
Well, on the work on this piece of road that was being created, there was a warden, and he worked directly for the warden. And basically, he would, you know, carry messages from the warden back to the warden's family or back to headquarters. He would also arrange for supplies, and he would oversee the at night to make sure all the prisoners were there and they didn't take off.
So while he was running as a messenger back and forth, going to the warden's home, was he supervised by a prison guard with a weapon, or was he just allowed to roam on his own?
He was allowed to roam on his own, the thinking being that where they were building this road was such terrible conditions. If you got off the road, you would be disoriented within minutes. So there was limited fear that he would ever run away.
So you're better off staying there rather than running away.
Correct.
But one of the things you had said was bringing messages back and forth to the warden's wife and family. So he went to the warden's home unattended?
Yeah, the warden was quite a ways away from where his family was. And, you know, the warden would send messages to be taken to his wife and family, and they would send messages sent back. So I could see where he would leave early in the morning, spend a lot of the day on the road getting there, arrive in the afternoon, have tea with the warden's wife and daughter. The daughter happened to be of marrying age. And apparently he struck up quite an interest in the daughter.
Well, it's kind of an interesting concept to think about. He's a convict. He's an Irish Catholic, and they're now assuming that the warden is either English or Australian, but would also be Protestant. And you have this Irish Catholic convict in your home with your wife and your daughter of marrying age, and he's unchaperoned, unsupervised. They must have put a great deal of trust into John Boyle O'Reilly to be able to give him that position.
I never met John Boyle O'Reilly, but he was apparently a pretty good guy at making friends, and he seemed to befriend everyone, and everyone liked him and trusted him.
He's a regular Joe Zavante. He's got that Zavante-like quality that makes everyone just love you.
So. Yeah, it does. He actually did share his plan to escape with another priest, Father McCabe. Father McCabe said, "This is never going to work. I'll arrange for you to meet a third priest, Father Mack, who can help you with your plans." And Father Mack came along about 8 months later, helped him escape. It was a 2-hour horseback ride and then a 12-mile ride in a rowboat to get to the shore where he could be picked up by ships.
So he meets the first priest in the library, who gives him a job there, and through that connection gives him some benefits and able to move up the chain. He meets a second priest in whom he confides his want and desire to escape, and instead of the priest talking him out of it, the priest just tells him, you know, this isn't the right time, that he would get someone else, and now we have a third priest coming in and is going to help him plan his escape.
Correct.
This is going to be the luckiest guy in the world to, you know, with the things that have happened to him, he probably should have been dead by now.
Yeah, but he was lucky, and they chose the escape date primarily because there was a boat race that day, and everyone was paying attention to the boat race, so it was a good time for him to get away. He waited, and the first ship that he was supposed to go for, get on, reneged, and sailed without him, and he was able to get on the second ship, which turned out to be an American ship.
So the ship he got on, did it take him to America, or did he?
No, it turns out that they were actually going to Liverpool first, so he had to go to Liverpool with the ship.
Okay. So now he's back in England, the place in which he was arrested and convicted and sent to prison. So what did he do? Did he just hide on board deck in the ship until another?
No, he hid in somebody's house, but for a month. He couldn't be out walking around or anything. Okay. So he stayed in the house for a month and then got on this ship that took him to Philadelphia.
Okay, so now he's on board ship, and how number of weeks from there to America, or?
Yeah, that's a much shorter trip. Yeah. It's more like about a month.
Okay. So Before we go on to America, and that's actually something that I'm going to ask you to hold off on and come back, and we'll discuss that another time, because there's a lot of great things that he did in America, including ending up here in Charlestown. But there's been some speculation, and it could just be a little bit of romanticism or whatnot, but I've heard stories that the warden's daughter was a little bit sweet on John Boyle O'Reilly, and that she might have been slightly instrumental in helping the priests assist him in escaping. Is there any truth to that?
Well, there is that. I've read that same material, but something happened, because at one point during this relationship, John Boyle O'Reilly actually tried to take his own life.
Okay.
And so there was the people suspected that maybe he was rebuffed by the...
the warden's daughter.
By the warden's daughter, or maybe the warden himself, or maybe the warden's mother, but...
Did either of the priests ever get found out that they were assisting him?
No.
So this was the perfect escape. Perfect escape. He was able to get out, he was able to be assisted, and no one ever found out who the conspirators were.
That's correct.
Oh, that's great. That's great. Well, we're going to stop that point at that point here. We're going to have David Hennessy back again with us next month. I believe the next time I'm going to be doing a show will be on December 11th, and David hopefully will be with us then. And we will discuss what John Boyle O'Reilly did when he came to America. And one of the things that he did was he was very political, although never an official politician. He became editor and publisher of the Pilot newspaper, which I believe is the country or the world's largest Catholic newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
So he was very instrumental in doing that, and he spent his life in Charlestown, so we'll be talking about that on the next show. To the people in Charlestown, this has been a very difficult few weeks for us, and at this point, I want to keep in our thoughts and prayers some of the families in Charlestown. And to the parents out there, tonight is a good night to just give your children an extra big hug and squeeze and let them know that you love them. For all of us here at Charlestown Live, I'm Tom Coots, and I'd just like to say, Charlestown is always, I remain yours. Good night.
Remember Charlestown, now and forever. God bless Charlestown. Good night.